Hello, everybody. I believe we can start. My name is Livnat Per. I have been working at Red Hat for the past almost five years. And I'm here today to share with you why Ovirt is a great choice when it comes to managing your KVM-based virtualized data centers. How many of you have heard about Ovirt before? Wow, that's a good crowd. And how many, so you're familiar with OpenStack? How many are familiar with OpenStack? Okay, great, last one question. And VMware? Okay, so I have a good audience here. I want to start with a short story. So 5 years ago, there was a startup named Kumranet. And they had many talented engineers. One of them is Avi Kiviti. He's the founder of KVM. In Kumranet, they had two projects. I mean, they had multiple projects, but KVM was obviously the most big and important and the focus of the company. But the company also wanted to enable the KVM-based virtual machines, so they had to work on their own project for managing those virtual machines. Obviously, the KVM guys will try to convince you that this is great. Using command line, well, and I'm sure everybody likes it, but it doesn't scale. Well, it is scale, but it's not user-friendly, I would say. Depends on the users, again. So in Kumranet, they had the management solution to be able to have a higher level orchestration operation like VM migration, scheduling of VM, VM placement, if you're familiar more with that term, and KVM, obviously. For me, and that's the last personal part here, I joined Red Hat to work on open source projects, and I joined Red Hat to work on Java. Part of the management solution we're going to cover today is written in Java. Part of it is in Python. So I joined to work in Java on open source project, and I came to the company, to Red Hat, and my first task was to work on a closed source project written in C#. Yeah, so they actually acquired Kumranet. It was one of the acquisitions they made at the time. And my first task was to convert the code to Java and to make sure it's open source within the next few, I would say years now, but yeah, it took us some time. But we got there. So that's how Ovirt started. And now we'll start looking into the bits. So what is Ovirt? It's a management, centralized management solution focused or tailored for KVM as a hypervisor. It leverages all the Linux good stuff, scalability, security, and it is open source. It's an open source alternative to vSphere, VMware, and vCenter. Who is behind it? So we have all the big companies, part of the governance that we have. Ovirt is obviously supported by IBM, Red Hat. I'm working for Red Hat. And Intel, NetApp, etc. Ovirt is by default package for Fedora and the Linux CentOS. But there is community work currently to package it for Gentoo, I believe, Ubuntu, Debian. And you can choose your flavor of Linux, go to the website and see if it is being supported. Just one last note, Red Hat Enterprise Virtualization product is derived from the Ovirt project. So what setup do we support? What kind of workloads are we expecting? Well, it's not the workload, it's still the deployment part. So basic stuff like one host, multiple virtual machines. On the data center is a logical entity that is being a container for all the resources required by the virtual machine, like storage, network. A more interesting deployment would be a multiple host environment with a cluster. Cluster is a migration domain in Ovirt. That means all the virtual machines can migrate from one hypervisor to another. I'm going to use the word host, hypervisor, and node, interchangeable, if you don't mind. All about physical machines. Actually, I have this, so I can do it like that. A more interesting setup would be to have multiple data centers, multiple clusters in each one, and VM migrating between the different hosts in the same cluster. So that would be like a typical deployment of OVIRT. Who is our audience? What kind of users does OVIRT support? So we have three types. The most basic one is the sitting penguin. He doesn't do much. He actually only consumes his virtual machines. He can start and stop. Just to make sure you know what I'm... So this is like the user portal. He logged in. He can see his virtual machine that were already allocated for him by the administrator. He can play. He can stop his virtual machine. And basically, that's it. So it's quite a basic user. A more interesting user is the dancing penguin, which is the self-provisioning portal. He can basically also create virtual machines for himself based on a quota that was allocated to him by the administrator. So there is a quota for the CPU, for the storage, for the memory. So he gets a predefined quota and can create his own virtual machine, also based on templates. Templates is something I'm going to describe a little bit later, but it's just like a static version or an image of image and virtual machine configuration. So it's an aggregation of all of that. It's and can be used for creating a virtual machines. And the last user, which we're going to focus on today, is the administrator. The last user is the administrator with a great toolbox. So this is what he gets. This is the administrator portal. He can manage technically all the resources. He can configure the network. He should configure the network and the storage and create the VM templates, whatever he wants. And we'll see what great functionality he has to play with or to use. So those are the three types of users that we have in OVIRT. When it comes to choosing your management solution, then for me it's about three things you have to consider. One of them is simplicity. You don't want to spend your time configuring the management solution. You want to spend your time on capacity planning. You want to spend your time on deployment, or architecture of deployment, whatever you want. You don't want to waste your time on patching the management because it's boring. That's why the management is there. It should already be ready. It should be customizable. If you want to have a specific enhancement, you should be able to do that. But out of the box, it should be as simple as possible. Second thing I would consider is stability. Nobody likes his workload crash, burns. Nobody likes his database loss. Nobody likes his data disappears. So stability is definitely one of those considerations when it comes to choosing your management. And the last one, functionality. Obviously, you have to understand what kind of workload you want to use, you have, and what kind of functionality you need, and only then choose your management solution. Because you can go to and choose a big solution, a big complicated management solution that would be too big or too complicated for you to use, while you can use something simple and get the same basic stuff that you actually need. So it's kind of important considerations when it comes to choosing your management solution. So let's see how OVIRT meets those criteria, or what OVIRT has to offer on those criteria. Okay, when it comes to simplicity, let's start with installation. So installing OVIRT is as simple as yum install, technically, if you have Fedora or RHEL or CentOS. So you do yum install, and then you run up the engine config. Quite simple. You have your setup up and running. So installation-wise, it's quite comfortable. User interaction. So everyone has his own special favorite way to communicate with the application. So it could be an intuitive UI if you're using a UI. It could be a Python SDK or CLI if you're Python enthusiastics. And it could be a Java SDK if you come from Java. So if you come from Java, you don't want to use Python probably, and the other way around. So you have all those choices in OVIRT. An intuitive web UI, Python CLI, and Python SDK. You can obviously go also to the REST API, which is available if you really want to do all the technical stuff, all the programming stuff against the API, the REST API. The next thing is Ovirt Node. Ovirt Node is just enough Fedora to be able to function as an hypervisor. So Fedora has a lot of packages, and you not necessarily want all of them for if it's going to serve only as an hypervisor. So what we did in Ovirt is we packaged Fedora, just enough Fedora, it's about 170 megs, the image size, to be able to function as an hypervisor. That makes our life easier and the user's life. Well, when it comes to security, I think you can all, you know that the less packages you have, the better security you can get. So that's why we have Ovirt Node. Configuration-wise, so let's assume you already set up your environment and you can use Ovirt and everything is fine, but now you want to tweak it. So you have a centralized place where you can tweak all the configuration that is related to Ovirt, which is a big benefit that you don't have to look for specific configurations. If you use management solution before, you always know that you have to go to different consoles and different config files and look for it. So in Ovirt, it is all in one place, one utility that you can use. Okay, so there's also a quick start for those who are interested in doing a quick proof of concept. Then you can do YAML install Ovirt and you can use the all-in-one plugin. The all-in-one plugin will deploy your management solution, your hypervisor, your database, and your local and your storage on the same machine. So that would be like a quick start if you have a single machine and you just want to know what Ovirt is, then that would be a good way to start. You can then do the engine setup, connect to the UI, and there you go. Now, to make this session more interesting, I chose to do a live demo now. What I did, I did do some making sure that everything works, basically, is I have my laptop, and on that I have a virtual machine running. In that virtual machine, I did the installation and the configuration just to save us time. And on that virtual machine, I'm going to use a nested virtual machine to bring a VM within a VM, just to see if it's working and just so you to prove the experience. One thing I did in addition to those two steps, so I copied an image to the ISO domain. I would show you why. I wanted to save time again, not because it's too complex. Okay, so this is after the installation bits, you're going to the web UI and you get the user portal, the Ovirt portal. You have a user portal, you have the administration portal, and you have reports. Well, that's an advanced functionality. I'm not going to demonstrate that. So we're going to the admin. What I'm going to show you is how quick it is to set up your own virtual machine. So it's a little bit slow because of the nested virtualization I have here, and so bear with me. It's not over it, it's just my laptop. So this is what you get once you're done with the all-in-one installation. You get a dedicated local data center, a storage with ISO domain. ISO domain is the domain that holds all your images for the virtual machines. You can boot from disk from the images in the ISO. Local storage is used for when I create a new disk for my virtual machine, it is being stored on the local storage. Template cluster, one cluster by default, which is a local cluster. Hosts, which includes my own host because I used all in one setup. So my host should appear here. And VMs. So I want to create a new VM. All I have to do is go to the virtual machine tabs, and actually that's the default, I just played it with here. And I'm going to a new VM, and give it a name. Live demo. You can give a description if you want. In this case, I would go to the boot options. We're going to cover all of this a little bit later. I just want to show you how easy it is to start a VM. So boot options, I want to start this VM from a CD, not from Pixie, I don't have Pixie here. CD, I want to attach a CD. I copied two images, one is the tiny, just a tiny image of Linux, so the VM would start. After creating the VM, I can configure another disk and another network interface, but I don't want to do it right now. I just want to create the VM. So the VM was created. Here is the VM. I can start it. And then we're going to see, you can see here the status, which is wait for lunch. I'm not sure you can see it on your on the big screen. Yeah. Well, this reflects the status technically. And in a second, I'm going to show you, we're going to open a console to the virtual machine. So this is a console to your virtual machine. I'm going to boot the image. Hopefully it would work. And we'll see the console there. So creating a virtual machine is as easy as that when you do a POC, which is quite easy to get started with. So for booting Linux should be faster than that, I believe. No, but hopefully it would be fine. In the meantime, the UI comes up. And here we have Spice. Spice is a protocol, an open source protocol which is optimized for virtualization, for connecting to your virtual machine. It's quite, it's not the purpose of this session, but it's also, okay, so the point was that you saw the VM. I don't want to spend the time. I believe you know how Linux looks like. So we have a running virtual machine. It's as easy as that. Just to show you the functionality that we have here before we move on. So when you create a VM, in addition for choosing a name and the basic stuff, there is advanced options. What can you control? You can control the high availability. You know what? I want to make sure I have enough time. So I'll go over the slides, and then if we have time, I would come back here and show you on the live demo some great stuff. But I don't want to spend all the time on that. Okay, so live demo checked. Worked. okay, this is a backup in case the live demo didn't work. We're fine, okay. So going on to stability. So the first thing was simplicity. I hope you got the point that it's quite simple to get started with OVIR. The second thing is stability. So I believe that if you can see that big companies are working on a project, it not always means that the project is stable and mature, but it definitely means that there are big companies that believe in that project. And that is something we can take out of the fact that we have so many big companies involved. In addition, we have the Red Hat Enterprise Linux Virtualization product based on OVIRT, and we have customers, so it's an enterprise-grade management solution that for sure indicates stability. We have an open governance model, which is not about the technical stability, but more about the stability of the open source project. We have, it's based on merit, so if you're coming and you're contributing enough, you're becoming part of the community, you can definitely get an influence position in the project. And we have a regular release schedule. Well, in the past 2 years, we released every 6 months. But lately, we've discovered that there are many features that go into each release. So we are working to make the release schedule on a 3 month cycle based, because we want our user to be able to get more feature faster, because the upstream moves quite fast. We have, this is the last point, we have an active user community, many contributions from various companies, many features go in. We want to make sure we release in a fashion manner, I mean, quite often. So we have a regular release schedule. We have stabilization period. In upstream, we want to make sure, well, I'm sure that if you contribute to an upstream project, you know that it sometimes tends to break. So we are trying to make sure this doesn't happen in OVIRT, and we are working to have stabilization period in which you can't push new features. You can just stabilize what you already have. Those are short periods, though. And community test days, which we have all hands on board with testing to make sure we have everybody that is testing somebody else's features to make sure we get more stability, we know how to use the product that we are working on, which is great. Continuous integration. On each patch that is being sent to OVIR, there is a set of tests that being executed automatically. So Gerrit could be, so Jenkins can give Gerrit a plus one if the tests are passing. So it's just the technical stuff, but it shows you that we care about stability and we are trying to do our best to make sure it is not broken. The active community users, I've mentioned one other deployment in production I wanted to mention is Alterway, which is a France hosting company. The reason I wanted to mention that is because they're hosting our continuous integration servers. So thank you. It's like a thank you note. Stability-wise. Oh, just to make sure, the point is that we have all these mechanisms in place. We are doing our best to make sure everything is stable, and it seems like in the past 2 years we were able to release quite good releases with many features involved, and so far, except for some exceptional things like I was able to delete my storage domain, how can I recover from that, other than such funny use cases, then it's quite stable. We didn't get any big complaints on stability. Functionality-wise. So functionality-wise, we cover two aspects in OVIR. There is the full environment stuff, which is the data center, the general data center, and there is the VM-oriented mechanism. So one of the goals that we had is to be able to configure anything within OVIR. You don't have to go out, well, except for specific stuff, you don't have to go out to another console and manage your stuff from an additional console and then from additional console. You can do everything from within OVIR. It starts with adding a host to your environment. You want to scale your environment, you want to add a host. All you have to do is go to the, I'm going to show it to you on the demo. All you have to do is go to the UI, click the add a host button, give IP address, the root password, and everything is provisioned for you. So that's quite good, I believe. There is another option. You can use an auto-registration mechanism if you use the OVIRT node that I've mentioned earlier. You can also use another flow for adding a host to your environment, which is the host register itself in the management, and all you have to do is look at the fingerprint and approve the host to add it to your environment. So you control the host environment, you control the networking configuration. We are basing currently our network, separating the different users' network based on VLANs. That's one aspect, but we obviously don't control the switches or the forwarding elements on the way, so you have to configure the switches to configure a trunk or specific VLANs that you want. So this is not done within OVIRT, obviously. We do have an integration with Neutron, which is the OpenStack networking component that enables also VXLAN and GRE tunnels. It's just a work in progress. I mean, the integration is already there, and I'm going to mention it later on, but that's not one of the mature features that we have. So you can configure the network with it over it. You can configure the storage. You can choose, we support many We support block device storage, and we support NFS or general POSIX storage. Everything could be and Gluster, of course, integration with Gluster. Everything can be configured within OVIRT. We can see the screens later. Resilient policies. So out of the box, you get two policies for scheduling your VMs. One of them is evenly distributed when your workload is evenly distributed between the nodes, and the other one is power save when we're trying to reduce the amount of physical resources we're using. So those are two out-of-the-box policies you get with OVIRT. But there is now on the upcoming release, which is actually it was already released last week. So OVIRT 3.3 offers a pluggable mechanism for scheduling. So you can write your own scheduler if you'd like using Python, and then your own policies would be implemented. You can also control the quota and network quality of service. Everything is on the data center level. The other aspect is your virtual machine. Obviously, creating a new disk, attaching a disk to your virtual machine, attaching your virtual machine to a network, all the basic stuff, it can be controlled within OVIRT. You can also mark the VM as highly available. For those special VMs that you really care about and you want to make sure OVIRT is also monitoring your virtual machine, and in case of a crash, it or the hypervisor crash, or the specific the VM crash, you want it to be restarted on another node, then you can specify it on the virtual machine level. And some fine tuning. As I mentioned, we have a lot of things that are tailored and enhance or leverages KVM specifically as a hypervisor. So the fine tuning can be done on the VM level. You can pass parameters directly to the Linux kernel, and that's quite good when you want to work with virtual machine and do some fine tuning. There is also advanced functionality. So we have a history database and reports. We're going to see some of it. Well, not the history and database, but there are some built-in reports that you can get on your virtual machines and on your hosts and your general statistics and data center, the way you use your resources. You have quota. One of the good things, or one of the things I like in Ovirt, is that you can delegate permissions to users. So it's not just that you have the administrator. If you're an administrator and you want to delegate some permissions, you can definitely create a role for that and have users associated with that role to be able to do just specific stuff. If you have a storage administrator and you don't want him to mess with your virtualization resources or virtualized resources, you can just give him a storage-related tasks, and that is all he'll be able to do. Based on the role that you gave him. So we have quota, which caps the users with CPU, memory, and storage. Neutron and Glance integration. So I saw that some of you, or actually many of you, are familiar with OpenStack. We wanted to leverage some of the technologies that are available in OpenStack within Ovirt. So we integrated with some of the component. It's still not mature and still being worked on, but in terms of networking and storage, we integrated with Neutron and Glance. For specific details, you can always go to our website, or you can come and ask me later specifically on the integration with Neutron. I can give you much more details. So we have that in place. VM Live Snapshot with RAM. There was a session about it yesterday, so taking a snapshot. Maybe it's worth mentioning what's the VM life cycle before I'm going to the VM Live Snapshot stuff. You know what? I pause. Do you guys have any questions before I move? I'm going to describe the VM Live Cycle, just to make sure that we're fine.
Question for you.
Yeah.
What is the overt footprint of KVM? You know, are you using plain pure KVM, or are you putting extensions into it to do live migrations and so forth?
What do you mean by extensions? We're using whatever is available in upstream.
Plain
KVM.
Yes,
no tweaks, KVM, QMU. I can see that you showed the command line at the beginning. That was actually something we generated. Yeah.
You said that you wanted the overt node based on Fedora.
Yes.
So you get a newer version of KVM and the kernel for those.
Yes.
Until we get Glance integration, what image formats?
Ooh, I'm not familiar with Glance. I'm working on the networking stack, and I'm working on Ovirt for a long time, but I'm not familiar with storage. But I do have someone in the audience that can... Itamar, can you stand up?
What is the question?
I was interested in image formats. Until you get Glance integrated, what formats do you support?
We support RAW and QCAL as image formats. Via OVF, but you can use the Virt V2V tool to convert from Xen, VMware, etc. to our OVF format.
Okay. Yeah, sorry, Glance is not my domain. Yeah.
What is the native way in which you deal with the networking virtualization now? Just VLANs and bridges?
Yeah, okay, so the basic out-of-the-box stuff, yes, it's VLAN and bridges and Linux bridge. But we have integration with Neutron, and there we can use VXLAN and GRE tunneling.
And now they are configured on all the nodes automatically by Ovirt.
Yes, by Neutron, by Ovirt and Neutron. Yes, technically
no,
yes.
Without Neutron.
No, we're deploying Neutron for you, basically. Okay. That's the way. The accurate flow is that you have to deploy the Neutron service. We have a mechanism to do that, but you get that in I mean, you can take the upstream, but there are specific versions that we support, so you have to deploy the service yourself. But all the agents on the host overdoes that for you. It also configures and do the fine-tuning on the host level, so you don't really have to go and do it manually like you have to do it in Neutron. So we took Neutron and we tried to wrap it to make it more easy to consume, because Overt users are quite regular to having everything prepared for them. They don't like to do like a lot of bashing and stuff. But so we wanted to make sure it's easy for users, that it's intuitive. So except for the service that we are working on, I mean, I assume that in a few months we'll have it deployed also by Overt. At this point, you have to deploy the service and the nodes, we are doing it for you. Okay. Yes. Yeah, so there is some community work to package Overt to a different Linux distributions. I think somebody worked on Gentoo, for example. I know somebody was working on Debian. I'm not sure about Ubuntu. No, Ubuntu.
There's an Ubuntu guest agent, and there is we're almost done on the BDSM and the engine support for.
So we are working on that. It's not available yet. Well, the guest agent, that means which flavors of virtual machines we're supporting. So that's basically all Linux flavor, I would say, and Windows, of course.
But sorry, you have to distinguish between like the platform and the guests that you can run on top.
Yes.
Yes, I know. Yeah. We are using all Overt in test environment and Red Hat Enterprise Virtualization in production. We have in RTHV, we have about 200 guest servers, all with SUSE Linux 10 and 11. But I need this really nice thing that I can see in manager, IP address, network utilizations.
The Overt guest agent.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so maybe I should. Okay, one last question, and then I want to move on to just to be able to cover the architecture a little bit. And you can always grab me after the session. I'll be happy to answer questions.
What about the networking? Do you have the quotas?
I didn't hear you.
What about quotas for the networking?
What about?
Quota for networking.
A quota. Yeah, okay. Yeah, of course. So currently, there are two levels of quotas. There is the capping on the VNIC specific to make sure a specific virtual machine doesn't take over all the bandwidth. And there is capping on the network level. For example, you have different tenants or different users with different networks. You don't want one network to take over all the bandwidth. So for the guests specifically, we already have that. So you can configure, you can cap your VNIC traffic. Okay? But on the network level, it's something we are working on. It would be available on the next version. There are already patches that are being worked on. So was I clear? You understood the two levels that we have?
Yes. Is there an InfiniBand support?
InfiniBand?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's a good question. Theoretically, it should work, because we have somebody that is using InfiniBand that did some testing and write on the Overt users community, but I didn't personally test it, so I don't know. But there was some correspondence on that.
I just wanted to say for the quotas, there's a presentation on quality of service which will cover all of the quota capabilities of 330 in the KVM forum.
Yeah, so we have a number of sessions over today and tomorrow. I'm going to mention that. But I want to be able to cover architecture a little bit just because to make sure we all know what we're talking. So the basic thing is, and that's really high level, is that you have the engine currently written in Java. It's highly, it's centralized management solution. So this is like the brain. And we have on each physical node, we have an agent, which is VDSM written in Python. On the client side, I already mentioned, you have many flavors of clients you can use. The more interesting, can you see it? I can't see it. Okay, so maybe just a little bit more in-depth architecture is that we have the engine. We're using a Postgres database, so it's all obviously open source. We support, for authentication, we support LDAP directory in general, and specifically we also support Active Directory for Microsoft. We expose REST API on top of the engine. And I've mentioned the client, so we have the SDK, the admin portal and the user portal that you guys saw. We have on the host, we have the VDSM. There is a host and node to differentiate between a full-blown image and just the overt node version. On top of that, you can run a virtual Linux-based virtual machine and Windows-based virtual machines. We have guest agent for your flavor of virtual machine that enables us to do things within the guest. For example, to view the applications that are running within the guest, to be able to have a single sign-on for the guest and from the user portal and other functionalities. We have the SPICE protocol is not formally part of OVIRT, but it's an open source project for connecting to your virtual machines. You can use the SPICE either from Linux or Windows machine. And storage, we have local storage. So we enable to utilize your, if you have a hypervisor and you want to utilize its local disk, you can do that by configuring a local storage and using that. And we have shared storage to be able to migrate a virtual machine from one node to another, you have to have, the easy way is to have a shared storage that is accessible from within the different physical node. So we have shared storage. In the guest, there are multiple drivers, virtual drivers for improving performance. I don't want to get into the details, but to improve performance for storage and networking. We also have the virtual serial that our agent uses. Currently, there's also iSCSI, virtual SCSI driver within the guest. So all of these to improve performance. So you get a nice performance. Customization options, we have multiple ways you can customize OVIRT to meet your requirements. One of them is on the agent, we call the agent VDSM. It's on the agent level. VDSM technically using LiveVirt, and LiveVirt is using KVM at this point for everything that is related to the VM lifecycle management. We have a way that you can write a hook, a script, and deploy it on the host, which can manipulate the LibVirt DOM XML. If you're familiar with how it works, it's technically VDSM is taking into consideration a lot of the parameter it gets. At the end of the day, it creates a DOM XML which represents your virtual machine, and then it launches the VM using LibVirt launches the VM using KVM QMU. So you can go and manipulate the XML the way you wish. It's usually useful for testing new features that just got into KVM and they are not leveraged in OVIRT yet and you want to give it a try. So that would be a good way to do it, doing this customization. An example of such a hook would be, so now we have a watchdog emulated device within the guest. So you can make sure from KVM, it's a feature that exists in KVM and we leveraged it in the last release. It's like a hardware emulated card that the guest, there is a daemon within the guest that touches this card, and if it doesn't touch it for a configurable amount of seconds, then the machine can reboot or stop, depends on the action you provide to the watchdog. So for example, before we incorporate this feature, we just had a hook, so you could use this feature even before it was part of the product. We have a mechanism to extend the UI. This example is how many of you are familiar with Foreman? Okay, so maybe I should just go to this and Nagios? Okay, so let's look at this. Technically, there's a way to extend our UI to integrate with external components. So for example, NetApp has such an option if you can get statistics from the storage. This specific is for Nagios. You can get statistics from the host and different events that happened on the host. So there is a full tutorial. Bless you. There's a full tutorial on the website you can use to customize and do your own flavor of UI. Okay, so, yeah, good, okay. I have 1 minute left, so what I wanted to make sure before we, maybe I'll takes a few minutes to show you things in the demo, but I want to make sure that the general idea is that Ovird is tailored to KVM. I think that's the benefit you can get out of Ovird. So it leverages specific thing, and if you don't want to use multiple types of hypervisor, if you don't have this specific urgency to use Hyper-V or something, then you can simply use Ovird, which is quite tailored and easy to use, easy to consume. It provides a lot of functionality, a lot of advanced functionality. Some of it I did not cover today, but you're welcome to come to our booth and see some of it. I think it's usable, and you have a good community to support you if you have questions. I find it a likable project because I've been working on it for 5 years, so I better feel like that. And I would love to get your questions now, I think, till I'm setting up the demo. You can get Ovird, by the way. If you just go to download, you can get it here, live USB. It's as simple as plug it into your laptop and try. Fedora repositories, you can build it from source if you're really adventurous. And you are welcome to contribute, even if it's just by stating your opinion and saying what features you're missing. We love getting feedback from the community. We love working on features that the community asks for. So definitely joining the community could help. Thank you, but I want to show you something else in the demo. Okay, so maybe just a quick coverage of what you get. Okay, so this is the data center clusters and the host. I don't have many entities here because I didn't want to do too many actions before I was able to show you the demo, but there is a great intuitive search in here. Yeah, but... Oh, so you there's an autocomplete. So if you're looking for a host with specific VMs on it or specific template, let's do VMs. And I specifically chose, I don't remember, I call it something like live demo. Mm-hmm. So you can get your, okay, so this is the host, there's a single host. So it's not really functional when you have single entity to do a search mechanism, but it's quite intuitive and there is autocomplete mechanism, which is really useful. On each entity, you can see there is sub-tab with the specific sub-entities. So for example, for host, you can see all the virtual machines that are running on that host. On the network, you can see, this is the main tab. So for specific network, you can see general information, in which cluster it's available, which hosts have this network, which virtual machines are using this network, which is quite useful, template permissions, which user is able to use this network, etc. We have the storage, maybe just a new domain. You can see here that we support NFS. Well, it's a local data center, so there's only local interfaces, but there is also iSCSI. Okay, so I think the idea is quite clear. I don't want to do any more of this demo stuff, but I would be happy to get questions for the next. I don't know, technically we're out of time, but they don't kick me out, so I'm here. Yes?
At some point in the past, at least, it was only possible to have one type of storage per hypervisor. Is that still the case?
Unfortunately, yes, but we are working to make sure this goes away.
Okay.
Yes? Okay, so that's a delicate question. Technically, it depends on your workload. Telling the truth. So you probably heard the pitch about the cattle and the pets. Are you familiar with that? So, okay, let me be the first to tell you it, and I'm sure I'm just the first. You're going to hear it many times. So there's the pets. that you like to give it a name and you love it and you handle it and you care if something happens to it. Most of the applications these days are written in such a way that they have some kind of state, they are not cloud aware, they are not stateless, which is a requirement when it comes to cloud. So when you're looking at PET, you care about each virtual machine. Then you go to OVirt, okay? So this is definitely, you can configure highly available, you have a virtual migration to make sure you don't have any downtime on your virtual machine. That's definitely a benefit of OVirt. When it comes to cattle, you have many of those. You don't have name for each one. You don't care if one of them crashes. You simply launch another VM. There's no state. So it depends what kind of applications you're going to use, what type of workload you're going to use on your virtualized environment. If you don't care about your virtual machines, then you can go to a cloud-based solution. If you care about your virtual machines and you want to make sure they have state, then you can go to OVirt. It's not a clear cut, so you can definitely use OVirt if you want, if you have stateless virtual machines. There's no conflict there, but it depends on scale, I assume. Well, it's not true because I'm using OpenStack and I'm not sure what scale it goes to, so I don't know. Technically, that's the formal answer. Not saying any more than that. Yeah. Yes?
What are you using for monitoring?
For monitoring. Okay, so we have video. There are a few aspects. There is the host monitoring and there is the virtual. Okay, so we have VDSM, which is an agent on the host. So every statistics that is related to the host, the VDSM technically reports it back to the engine.
How do you gather that?
How do I gather? Oh, you were talking about the reports I've mentioned earlier? Okay, so we have history database. OVirt is using Postgres as a database. The database that we use on the day-to-day transactions, and then we have the history database, which aggregates every 1 minute the data from the statistics we gather on the regular database, the RDBMS. So we have the history database, and based on that, we have integration with Jasper, if you're familiar with that, to generate a report. Jasper is also an open source solution to generate reports based on the history database. You can also definitely make your own report, customized report tool. The database is part of a formal API. It's not changing. It's backward compatible, which is also a great benefit with OVirt. So we release every 6 months, but you do get an upgrade script, and you do get backward compatibility. We don't break backward compatibility. It's like one of the core things in our community, which is painful for us as engineers, but I'm sure as users you can appreciate that. So that answers your question. Where is it? The guy? Yeah. Okay. Good. Any other question? Yeah.
You mentioned you can have quotas for users. Does this also apply to groups of users? So you have
okay.
Users
with quotas? So we integrate with an external LDAP directory. If you can configure groups in your LDAP directory, then yes, it's fully integrated. Okay. So you can, for example, give a quota to a group of users, and then each user will get the same quota that you gave to the group.
But can they share the same pool?
Oh, the same pool.
So like I can give this group of users 100 gigs total.
Yeah. Well, the formal answer is no. But when we implemented this feature, we actually thought there are two ways. You can give a quota to a specific to a group, and there are two options. Either you want it to each one of the group. Yes, okay. He wants to kick me out. And there's an option to give it to them as a group, as one resource. We chose to go with the other implementation that it is per user. Okay? Thank you, everyone. I'll be here around.